それでは定刻になりましたので、JST のエラトプロジェクトとそれからアイスナーのこの合同のセミナーですね、ジョイントセミナーベッティングエラト JST エラト高原ソフトインターフェースプロジェクト and アイスナー So today's speaker is a professor Krzysztof Matyjaszewski andhe is from Carnegie Mellon University in the United States. And actually, he is a very, very famous professor and one of the pioneers of the Atom Transfer Radical Polymerization. And actually, he got a PhD from Moscow Technical University.And then he got PhD from Polish Academy of Science. And the, from 1985, he's a faculty member of the Carnegie Mellon University. And the, yeah, after that, he was promoted as a professor of the Carnegie Mellon University. And the, he developedATRP technique around 1996 or 1995. And the, he got many awards, and the, one of the most famous and recent one is a Wolf Award, and the, he got it at the same time.When the Professor Yamanaka got the class. So today he came here on the, after his visit to Europe, and he, just he flew from Frankfurt to Fukuoka, and he arrived here around 3:20 and then came here.To give a lecture for us. And the, yeah, after that, he will be visiting several countries in Asia and then move on to the United States. So it's a great honor for us to have visit here. And the title of his talk is ATRP from Synthesis to Application.So let's welcome Professor Matyjaszewski.
Thank you very much, Professor Bekar, for this very kind introduction. And it's a great pleasure to be in Fukuoka for the second time in a new campus. And previously, I was once or twice in the old campus, which was so close to the airport that I thought that I would make very easily from the airport to the lecture hall, but it was a bit longer previously. So I would like also to extend my congratulations to Professor Takahara, who was elected as the president of Japanese Polymer Society, which is a very prestigious honor. So congratulations, and you will have a president of most central person in polymer science in Japan in your country, so you should be very proud of that as well. So I decided to tell you today a little bit of the more materials focus rather than synthesis, but probably few slides guiding you how to design good atom transfer radical process. And I think that this really chemistry is quite important because it enables making polymers with complex architecture. So this would be making materials like block of polymers or gradients, molecular brushes, sometimes functional colloidal structure, and something which Professor Takahara is very famous and a pioneer work on the modified surfaces, which have sometimes very unusual and very special properties. But eventually, what is also important is really application. So what can be done with these materials? And I will show you at the end some applications, and some of them will be really coming from Japanese company, Kaneka, but also from PPG and some others. And during this 15 or maybe now 18 years from the time when we did first time the copper mediated process, we developed catalysts which are now million times more active than originally based catalysts on by Redeliotis. And I will show you some examples of these catalysts. And because of that, one could also reduce amount of catalysts from something like a 1 mole percent, which means 10,000 parts per million versus molar, to single digit ppm, sometimes even less than that. And also, we were able to run these reactions in water and sometimes in bulk without any solvents. And eventually, I should be quite happy with the 16 industrial licenses which were signed. And here is a list of more than 50 companies, and many of them from Japan, in fact, who are members of the Atom Transfer Radical Polymerization and eventually Controlled Radical Polymerization Consortium. And in fact, like in a case of Professor Takahara, most funding comes not only from industry, but in fact from the National Science Foundation or from government, if you wish, it would include also sometimes Department of Energy or Department of Defense and also National Institute of Health. So Professor Takahara mentioned that this controlled radical polymerization was reported more or less in 95. The first time, and you could see that number of papers on ATRP alone, these are these green bars, exceeds or reaches nearly 14,000, and it would be more than 1,000 papers published per year, which would be like a 3-4 papers per day nearly on ATRP alone, but also there are some other techniques like RAFT, which I will mention on the next slide, and also nitroxide mediated polymerizations, which are quite really popular and fashionable, if you wish. We organized so far 6 different symposia, and the 7th one will be around in San Francisco in August this year. And you could see also quite large activity in industry. Probably more than 3,000 patents were filed on various aspects of a controlled radical polymerization, which can be partially explained by this estimate made by Bob Matzer from DuPont, that they anticipated the market around $20 billion a year. It is not yet there, of course, but $20 billion a year is approximately 10% of all polymer market. But this is 10% not by volume, but by market share, not commodities, but high specialties like coatings, adhesives, surfactants, sometimes thermoplastic elastomers, sealants, cosmetics, biomaterials, electronic materials. So this would be something like a value-added system. So before 1995, essentially, this field of controlled radical polymerization practically didn't exist. And many people doubt that it can ever be leading radical polymerization or controlled radical polymerization realized in a sense of the anionic polymerization, which gives you very precise structures. And the problem with conventional radical polymerization is such that the propagation is very fast. Monomer adds to a chain end with a frequency approximately 1 millisecond. But after 1,000 monomer additions, after 1 second, there is a termination, and then new radical is born, generates this chain, which propagates very quickly and dies after 1 second. So 1 second time is too short to make any kind of a synthetic chemistry, to make block of polymer by adding second monomer, or putting in end functionalized structure. So it's very different from the cationic, like Professor Oshima is doing, or anionic polymerization, because two cations or two anions cannot react together because of electrostatic repulsion. Two radicals with diffusion control rate react one with another and annihilate. So the challenge was how one can extend this life of propagating chain from a second to something like an hour, or maybe even a day. So the concept which we introduced, and in fact it, everybody is using now, is that you can allow this radical to propagate maybe once or twice, and then you send it from the active to a dormant state. And then these species stay dormant maybe for tens of seconds, maybe a minute. And then the bond homolytically cleaves, regenerates a radical which can propagate once or twice, and then go back to a dormant state. So more or less what happens, you take this 1 second life of propagating chain and then you chop it on 1,000 pieces, 1 millisecond each, and insert 1 minute of a sleeping time in between. So this 1 second is 2,000 milliseconds plus 1,000 minutes, so it expands like accordion essentially to 1 day or sometimes even more. So this would be like, if you want to compare it with a person's lifetime, if Professor Takahara would be active for 1 day and then dormant for 1 month, of course it's impossible because he's too active to do that, he will live 30 times longer. So instead of 100 years, he will live 3,000 years. So people from the Jesus Christ time essentially would be still walking here if they would be able to be perfectly dormant in such a sense. So of course, we cannot do that, but this is probably the best comparison of fuels. So there are a couple of ways how one can realize this. So one can use that in a presence of so-called stable radical, something which you can buy from all the fuel, which would be something like nitroxide, like tempo. You could think also about organometallic species, so this would be cobalt porphyrin. So this is like vitamin B12 chemistry, essentially, converted to material synthesis. However, in both cases, you would need one of these blocking groups and couplers per chain. So if you think about cobalt porphyrin, it would be simply too expensive because you would buy maybe 1 gram for $100, so you cannot make it in a commercial way. So we are thinking about using something less expensive, something as cheap as bromine or chlorine. But bond between carbon and bromine or carbon and chlorine is so strong that you need to go to something like 300 degrees maybe to have it sufficiently divide. Then you have many side reactions and it is not what you would like to do. So you need to lower activation barrier from maybe 50 kilocalories per mole to 10 kilocalories per mole. How to do that? You can use catalysis. So in that case, you can use transition metal compound, which would facilitate clear bond because it forms a bond with this leading group, bromine or chlorine or sometimes iodine or sometimes pseudohalogens as well. And then these reactions can be done at room temperature, sometimes even at some ambient temperature. So these two processes, they rely on so-called persistent radical effect. But there is also another very successful process which relies on D-donor transfer. In that case, what you see here on the left side and the right side of this equation is exactly the same. So what is a driving force is essentially entropic exchange between these active centers and this atom, something like iodine, but can be also quite popular in Japan, derivatives of tellurium or even bismuth, which was done by Professor Yamago, and of course also dithioesters AF process. In that case, the principle is the same, but you shuffle this atom or group between many chains, and you have a very small amount, parts per million, or sometimes parts per billion, of radicals. And in that case, this bimolecular termination cannot happen because radicals are present at very low concentrations. But dynamics of exchange is of key importance because in that case, all chains should grow at the same time. So in conventional radical process, if you would take pentafunctional initiator, you will form one chain here, one chain somewhere else. You will never be able to make stars. But in controlled radical polymerization, these five initiators will start growing chains concurrently, and then you will have a star with five arms, or sometimes, as you will see, brushes with hundreds of the arms together. So this is a totally new quality, and it allows you to control very precisely macromolecular architecture. This is a very simplified animation to show you how this process may occur in atom transfer radical process. You have this activation, monomer addition, deactivation, activation, monomer addition, deactivation. So transition metal complex changes oxidation state from copper 1 to copper 2, iron 2, iron 3. And then, in fact, this is too simplified situation because you have a one catalyst per chain. In many cases, you can have a one catalyst and hundreds or sometimes even thousands of chains. So these catalysts will be activating, deactivating different chains and exchanging sometimes their activity as well. So if you look really how it started with atom transfer radical polymerization, we had concentrations of copper originally in a range of 1,000 ppm. Why? Because in radical polymerization always you have terminations. And this termination process must be somehow compensated by the large amount of catalyst, because otherwise all of copper 1 would go irreversibly to copper 2 and the reaction would stop. So originally this would happen. So we are thinking at the same time, because we measured the kinetics of these reactions, and we found that in fact parts per million of catalysts is enough to allow them to go concurrently. But you could not work with 5 parts per million or maybe 50 parts per million of the catalyst because of this irreversible termination. So we thought that if we know that this process will happen irreversibly, can we somehow regenerate, return this copper 2 back to copper 1 state? And how to do that? So you need some kind of a mild reducing agent. This mild reducing agent may be something like tin 2 compound, which is FDA approved, in fact, used sometimes as food preservation additive. You can use some phenols or sugars, amines, ascorbic acid, vitamin C works. You can use even a piece of metal. It can be copper, it can be iron, it could be magnesium or zinc. You can even use AIBN as a radical initiator. We call this process ICR for initiators for continuous activator regeneration. So this works very nicely. In fact, you could reduce the amount of catalyst, as you could see here, get practically colorless reaction mixtures. However, every act of regeneration would convert this reducing agent to oxidized agent. So for example, tin-2-octoate is FDA approved, but tin-4 compound is much stronger with acid toxin. If you start from AIBN, you will produce more alkyl chlorides, which means that they would initiate new chains. In fact, something like that happens also in raft polymerization. So you cannot make pure block of polymers this way. If you start with copper 0, you will put more copper to a system. So this is something which you would like to avoid. And the question is, how I can regenerate this catalyst back to the original state without forming this oxidized agent? So these reactions, in fact, are electron transfer reactions. So it is electron transfer, which means you need to supply electrons to the system. So why not to convert these reactions to something related to electrochemistry? So instead of putting chemical reagent, can I just plug in battery to my reaction mixture? And can I, by changing potential, for example, putting anodic current, stop the reaction, but putting cathodic current, can I restart the reaction? And by changing potential, I can select the right ratio of copper 1 to copper 2, and I can control rate of polymerization. So this was really a very simple concept, and in fact, it worked beautifully. So if you see here the classical cyclic voltammogram of this copper species, this is hexametallated trend, if I use quite positive potential, I have only copper 2. So I'm on this side of the equilibrium and there is practically no polymerization. But if I apply progressively more and more negative potential, I start increasing concentration of copper 1 until I reach essentially diffusion control limit for supplying catalyst to the electrode. And then I can return it back in a classical cyclic voltammogram arrangement. So now if you look what happens, if I am at negative 400 millivolts versus silver silver cation, you could see there is no polymerization. Then I increase potential to 700 and polymerization starts. And when I go back to 400, stops, starts, stops. And I can essentially continue the reaction with the rate I want. And also I can stop it at any time. And you could see that these reactions are very well controlled. Molecular weight increases linearly with conversion, and dispersities go down to a value 1.05, like in a very good anionic or cationic polymerization. Entire molecular weight distribution shifts towards higher molecular weight. So another approach is to, instead of using current, electrical current, I can use also light. So, in fact, what happens is that copper 2 species, copper 2 halide, can be photochemically reduced at irradiation at the right wavelength. So if you have a red LEDs here, so 650 irradiation, no polymerization. If I go to a blue irradiation, 450 reaction goes. If I go to violet, it's even faster. And even I can do that on a just exposure to a sunlight. This is a picture taken on the roof of the Mellon Institute, which Professor Takahara visited some time ago. We needed such a nice sunny weather like today in Kyushu, but in Kyushu, but probably a little bit warmer would be better today, I think. And you could see that here again, molecular weights nicely increase with conversion, and you have a dispersity sometimes below 1.1, which is again evidence of a very good control. We are using 100 ppm of copper, and practically nothing else. It acts as a reducing agent, and then sunlight or LEDs work quite efficiently. So to summarize the synthetic part, which I think is important, that you can go to a concentration of copper sometimes less than 50 ppm. In probably many cases, we can, especially going for higher molecular weight materials, below 20 or below 10 ppm. So for some applications, it's not needed in the removal of the copper, but it's also much easier to remove it if you have only 10 ppm rather than 10,000 ppm. And we can remove it also electrochemically, which I will discuss tomorrow during this symposium. So a key here is really to select right reducing agent, because if reducing agent would be too powerful, then it would too quickly return this copper to 2 copper 1, and you have more terminated chains. So something like really sugars, amines, you can use even monomer, dimethylaminoethylmethacrylate, sometimes even ligand can do that. You can use ascorbic acid, you can use even inorganic compounds like sulfites. So these sulfites are used as a wine preservation compounds, and sometimes people, especially in Europe, complain that they had a headache if they drink too much red wine. In fact, it's not correct, because red wine has only 100 ppm of sulfites. White wine has 200, and sweet white wine has 400. And dry apricots, they have a 1,500. And nobody complains of a headache from eating dry apricots, I think. So it's probably too much solvent rather than too much sulfites, I think so. So you need to really supply this reducing agent slowly. So sometimes if you use ascorbic acid, especially in water, is too strong reducing agent, too quickly will return. So you can feed it with a syringe pump or a dorp wise, if you wish. So you can control it by either strength or by rate of the addition. And this is especially important for some biological systems that they work in water, which is a very powerful active system. So of course, when you think about really what would be next in catalysis, we started in 95 with this normal ATRP. Then we used this low ppm copper, which we call target and ICAR. Then we used electrochemically controlled atom transfer radical process. We use now photo and also SARA, which would be something which I will briefly mention tomorrow. So the question would be, what would be next? And next is difficult to predict, and of course, one part of the next would be maybe going to even more bio-friendly materials catalytically. And in fact, if you look at the literature, there is two groups, one of my former postdoc, in fact, Fabio Di Lena, and the other one, Nico Bruns from Basel University. They look at the materials which are based on enzymes. Essentially, heme structure is capable of acting in an iron to iron free fashion. And they use horseradish peroxidase in some cases. In the Nico used very recently published paper, he took his own blood, and hemoglobin can act as a catalyst for polymerization. I'm not sure it is allowed in Japan, and in the US, I think it would be prohibited either, but it was his own blood, so he probably could do what he wanted. But if you look here at this control, it's not very good. You could see that polymerization starts and then stops at relatively low conversion. Molecular weight distribution is quite broad and practically does not increase molecular weight much with conversion. So there are a couple of reasons why it happens, but we were thinking also that this as a catalyst is probably, horseradish peroxidase or catalase, they will have a molecular weight in a range of 50,000 as an enzyme itself, 50 to 80,000. So if you want to make a polymer 50,000 molecular weight, you need to take by weight 1-to-1 monomer and your catalyst. So it's practically not that catalytic. So do we need all of this protein around? And in fact, you could really buy quite inexpensive heme, which has this iron chloride bromide bond. And you know, first thing which we did, we added excess of a salt in order to control the polymerization because of the potential dissociation of this bond between iron center and the halogen. But this was working to some degree only. So then we had a problem with solubility, so we added first pegylated structure here. And after pegylation, it would work not only in water, but also in anisole, and you have pretty good control. But you get polymers which are beautifully colored. So if you want to have a polymer which is deeply purple, it works very nicely because you copolymerize this catalyst with a monomer. So after hydrogenation, in that case, you get crystal white polymer because the catalyst cannot be incorporated to a polymer. And you could see that molecular weight nicely increases with conversion, dispersed by the range of 1.1 and 1.2. So I think this is probably one direction to use more bio-friendly and potentially less toxic catalysts as well. However, I think the question about the future is also related to materials. What can we do, or can we do with radical polymerization the same which is done in cationic polymerization or in anionic polymerization? Can we control to the same degree polymer composition, making not only statistical copolymers but blocks, periodic structures or gradients? Can we control shape of chains, not only making linear but cyclic stars, graphs, even networks with precisely controlled mesh size or sometimes hyperbranch like dendritic like structures? Or can we put functionality? And this is probably the biggest advantage of radical polymerization, because you can use unprotected acid or amines or alcohol, something which is very difficult or challenging to use in cationic or in anionic polymerization or coordination polymerization as well. And eventually, can we combine them together? So can we make a cyclic material which is also blocky and gradient? Can you make a nicto-arm star with two different arms, but also two different functionalities? For example, you can have a unsaturated structure for cross-linking, for solventless coatings, which would be photo-initiated, and also isocyanate, which can be controlled by urethane chemistry. Or can you make a pom-pom-like structure? And in fact, it's very easy sometimes to draw these structures, but a little bit more difficult to really prove that you can make them. And in that case, there are some techniques which allow you to really very precisely analyze your materials. And this is one of the examples. It's a molecular brush which consists of 400 repeating units of polyhydroxyethyl methacrylate, exactly the same chema which is used in contact lenses. And then we convert these hydroxy groups to bromoesters. And then subsequently, we grow these 400 arms progressively. So these materials are very complex. They have a molar mass in a range of millions, sometimes in tens of millions. And they behave in a very special way. They have a very interesting lubrication property, something like brushes which Professor Takahara makes by glowing from the surfaces. So these molecular brushes, they are, first when we try to look at them, they were more like essentially pleasing your eye concept. You could see them sometimes as a gradient. You could see this gradient of density. You could combine really brush with a single chain and sometimes collapse it even. You could have a crystallizable structure or sometimes even intercalated structures. You can make a starfish structures. And there are some really pleasing your eye really molecular architectures. But at the same time, you can use them for very special applications. For example, these block copolymer brushes, they would separate with a period in a range of hundreds of nanometers. And therefore, they can be used as a photonic material. Something was done by ATRP, but also Bob Grabs did similar chemistry with the metathesis as well. You can make them as a precursor sometimes for the super soft elastomers, but also materials which could be as carbon nanowires and sometimes control porosity and some others. And you can make them in various ways by grafting from, grafting through, and grafting onto. This is probably the most precise process when you start growing whole chains and they are really compatibilized progressively with the material. And in fact, very similar structures to the brushes is a work which we did somehow together with Kaneka by using the bifunctional macromolecules and monofunctional. After copolymerizing them, you could get a structure of a very loosely cross-linked brush because you have many, many dangling bonds. And they have unusually good properties for the vibration or noise dampening. It's an example of a test made with a Japanese raw egg, and you have this pad, very thin, and egg is an orbit, it doesn't break. And sometimes you can even go to a more challenging situation on the third floor, and I think that the most difficult is really to find this, but to not go in another position. So it's sticky because it's a polybutyl acrylate with a low TG material, but you can add a bit of a fluor acrylate, in that case the surface properties are different and TG can be still preserved. So another type of brushes are really brushes which Professor Takahara very often makes in a precise way. They can be made from a flat surface, they can be made from a curved surface, it can be convex or concave also. So one can go, in fact, inside the cylinder. So one can take mesoporous silica of a diameter 10 nanometers and grow very precisely polymer chains inside and make sometimes precursors for nanocarbon wires and sometimes even carbon nanotubes. What is important, of course, is attachment of the initiator to a surface, and it may be different chemistry for silica, different for gold, different for iron, oxide magnetic material, so silver, or sometimes compound semiconductors, cadmium sulfide or selenide, and others. So one needs to really know this chemistry, and then you can control also density. The highest density is in a range of probably one chain yield per square nanometer. So therefore, these brushes, they have very unusual properties because they are so dense that they cannot interpenetrate and cannot entangle. So they slide one on top of the other one. And so Takahara made marvelous examples of a very, very low lubricity material. So something similar was done by Jacob Klein some time ago. He said that he can push 1 ton of a load with a 1 gram force nearly. They are sliding so well, especially they are tetraionic materials with a phosphoryl coating, but some other tetraionic materials as well. Now, one important possibility is also that you can reduce even graphene density by putting some kind of a dummy initiators, and then you can have an entanglement if you want to, for example, for these spherical structures, you can have materials which will be behaving mechanically as toughen material, much tougher than the original, either polymer or short chains. And also you could see that can be very nicely ordered. So this would be a similar situation with photonic materials, where there is no really any dye or pigment added. You have this refraction because of a very precisely controlled distance between materials of the different refractive index. So this is a silica, I believe 200 nanometers or maybe 50 nanometers in this case, and the distance between them is around 100 nanometers. You can sometimes make these composite hybrid materials invisible if you match refractive index of a matrix with the hybrid material. And if you change refractive index by having some kind of a two-photon absorbing dye, in that case they can go to this from transparent and scattered material. You can go also to the materials which really start behaving like a crazy. I will probably have it on the next slide, in fact. So this is an example of the photonic-like material, which is also very flexible because of this entanglement. And you can think about potentially some inks or photonic paints, which would be much better than the classical colloidal crystal like, because they would be very brittle. And here is entanglement, if you want to reach that, they give you this additional possibility, and practically no cracking. Now, here's an example of the material which has, by volume, more than 50%, exactly 52% of the silica, and by weight, it would be 75%. So you have a material by weight, which is 75% glass, 25% polymeric glue, And you can have it as transparent, you can even extend it, and you see this example of a casing. It's a special case using polymethyl methacrylate, a very high molecular weight medium, and essentially the short styrene acrylonitrile chains which exothermically mix with the matrix. Now, another example is what I mentioned to you, that you can have a hard or sometimes soft template. So this was an example of a silica mesoporous structures when we grow polyacrylonitrile inside and then converted polyacrylonitrile into graphitic structures. And then this is this replica of a mesoporous structures from the silica. You can use the same with the colloidal silica particles, and then you have the matrix which would be polyacrylonitrile. How does it work? In fact, you convert this polyacrylonitrile at temperatures in a range of probably 250 degrees approximately to be cyclized leather-like structure. And then it is in the presence of oxygen, and then you can sometimes use the soft template structure, so having block of polymer of the polyacrylonitrile and polybutyl acrylate, and then you have structures which would give you either lamellae or sometimes continuous cylindrical or even carbon nanodots in some cases. And I will show you on the next slide some potential applications, but they can be used in electrocatalysis very efficiently, practically. You mentioned platinum, and also for CO2 capture, but also for supercapacitors with a very large surface area. And this nitrogen at the atoms at the end is pyridinic nitrogen, giving you this additional special functionality. So typically, we start, as I mentioned to you, from block of polymer. So this is polyacrylonitrile block with polybutyl acrylate. And then, depending on the volume fraction, we can have either spherical morphology, cylindrical, bicontinuous, or sometimes lamellae, and then inverted structures as well. As I mentioned to you, at 250 degrees, this polyacrylonitrile with cyclize and coslink, so it doesn't go for all the disorder transition temperature because it is fixed morphology. And then you need to remove oxygen because otherwise you will burn everything at higher temperature. And under argon or nitrogen, you essentially 450 degrees remove this polybutyl acrylate. And then you have first block of polymer, and then you have these carbonyl structures. In this particular case, it's lamellae. In this one, it's a cylindrical structure. And these are cylinders of filaments of a diameter approximately 30 nanometers. So if you look at the classical carbon fibers, which is in a range of microns, sometimes maybe 50 microns even. So 50 microns is a diameter of a human hair. And sometimes I ask students a question, if you take 1 gram of your hair, 1 cubic centimeter, how long single hair would be? And the answer, in fact, is that it should be in a range of 500 meters. So it would be around a solid state, if you wish, right? But if you go now from 50 micron to 30 nanometers, if you take the same 1 cubic centimeter, or let's say 1 gram, if density is close to unity, how long it would be? So it would be 2,000 by 2,000 times longer. So this is 1.5 million kilometers. And the thinnest we ever made, of course, never continuous, was in a range of 3 nanometers. So this 1 cubic centimeter would correspond to 150 million kilometers length. So these are really very materials with a very large surface to volume ratio. And therefore, they have very interesting properties by itself as components of nanocomposites, but potentially, you could think about also electronic materials. However, one of the interesting features is if you change really this morphology, if you go from the lamellae eventually to cylinders, you can end up also with the bicontinuous structures. And this has very interesting potential properties from a conductivity and even catalytic properties as well. If you think about really this thickness of this wall, it's a very large surface area, 500 square meters per gram. So from a Sachs pattern, you have a period in a range of 23 nanometers, but from nitrogen absorption, you have these pores which are 13 nanometers. So the wall is only 10 nanometers. And on both edges, essentially, you have nitrogen atoms with pyridinic nitrogen atoms. So they have a very intriguing properties, and one example is this electrocatalysis. We can have either four-electron one-step process, which would be very good for fuel cells, but also, if sometimes doesn't work, you can think about the two-electron two-steps. It can be for hydrogen peroxide formation or biosensors as well. And in fact, properties and number of the electrons, you could see we can go to four and sometimes to two, depends on many factors. So one important issue, of course, for if you look at this oxygen reduction process would be the potential, and you would like to have a S little negative value, and this value practically matches platinum. So you could see that if we go to too low temperature, 600 degrees, we have a large surface area, a lot of nitrogen, but properties are not very good because it's not yet conductive material. You need to go to higher temperature to graphitize it sufficiently, but if you go too high temperature, this doesn't work either because content of nitrogen drops too much. So we don't have these pyridinic nitrogens practically anymore. So something between 700 and 800 is the best. But you cannot start with polyacrylonitrile nitride because it doesn't have this nanostructure in the polymer. So surface area is much smaller, in a range of less than 100 square meters per gram instead of this 500. And one very important feature is, in that case, you go from 700 to 800 roughly. Is also how you prepare the sample. Because you can take an activated carbon even with larger surface area or even this material. If you use a binder, in that case it's typically Nafion used. In that case, if you use Nafion for it's the same sample here, you could see this is with Nafion and this is binder free spectrum. So the way it is done, you really deposit this block of polymer on the classic carbon electrode. And then you convert it to this carbon structure without any binder. And in that case, properties here are such that you get this four electron process and you have also this potential very close to platinum. You also use that for CO2. I noticed that you have this carbon neutral center here, so I thought it may be useful to show you that some of these materials with these pyridinic nitrogens are also quite efficient for the binding because you have these basic pyridinic structures binding CO2, and in fact the capacity for this material is in a range of 3 millimole per gram, so it would be like 15% more or less of the CO2 capture, but also it's a very fast process, and this is probably very important because not only capacity, but if you do it reversibly, it would be a question of the kinetics of trapping. And changing that from room temperature to 50 degrees, you will essentially absorb reversibly. Selectivity is pretty good. So this is absorption of CO2, and this is absorption of nitrogen. So these pyridinic nitrogens are responsible for this selective reaction. And it depends also how it's processed, that depends on the other structures. But I wanted to show you one more thing. It's another project which we were asked, in fact, by one company which was interested in making biofuels. So they do these biofuels essentially using algae. But algae rely only on 400 ppm CO2 which we have in atmosphere. And it takes them several months, essentially, to produce these biofuels. They would like to do that within a couple of hours. So you need to increase concentration of CO2, and the question is, where you can get it from. If it would be close to power plant, it's okay, but you don't have these big ponds where ideally it would be in New Mexico, maybe in a very sunny place. And how you can, instead of having point source capture, go to air capture. So practically in any place, you can get CO2 from atmosphere. So ideally, you would like to have some kind of a swing, in a sense, by either changing pressure, or changing temperature, or changing maybe humidity. In fact, humidity seems to be the most economically and energetically least consuming. So there was a paper published by Klaus Lackner now 2 years ago, where he used a resin which contains hydroxide anions. And then this hydroxide reacts with CO2, form bicarbonates, and under wet conditions, desorb CO2, and under dry conditions, reabsorb CO2, and then the cycle can be repeated many times. And he took the best available larger surface area material, which was excellium, and you could see here how this CO2 really changes absorption, desorption, changing humidity from 20 to 90%, so it would be maybe like in Kyushu summer and winter, I think right now would be probably less than 20. Summer maybe 100, I think sometimes. So originally we were thinking about these mesoporous structures because they would have a, for humidity, a large surface area. However, it worked only in one direction, in the sense that vapors of moisture, water, they absorbed, and by capillary forces they didn't want to get heat under dry conditions. So it was a very slow process. So we are thinking about really some kind of a bicontinuous structures, and also of the good connectivity, essentially. So we came with an idea which is based on a templating process, and the key would be to really have a very good penetration through a whole piece of the material, which could be some several millimeters or maybe even centimeters. And this is a real three-dimensional X-ray tomography, and you could see here that they are really perfectly interconnected because they are based on this replica of the colloidal crystals. We made them first by using either PMMA or polystyrene, latex surfactant free, and then you assemble them, and then you fill this interstitial space, which is approximately 25% of the voids, with the resin precursor and coslinker together. Then you coslink them, and you can, using THF or acetone, any organic solvent, remove this PMMA or polystyrene, and you are left, essentially, with this interconnected structure. You can exchange anions, sometimes you can use directly with hydroxide if you wish. So what you have here are these holes, half a micron, from this latex. And then they are connected to 12 neighbors with a size approximately 50 nanometers. So now it's a, as you could see, very nicely interconnected structure, and this X-ray tomography shows that it is very nicely assembled as well. So in comparison with this excelion, the size of a swing was three times larger, and rate was probably five times larger. But we are thinking, can we go from maybe 75% of these voids 95% of voids. How you could do that? I mean, you cannot do that based on spheres, but there is a very simple process based on high internal phase emulsion. Hypes can give you up to 95% of voids and still continue structure. Of course, they are not as beautiful as these highly regular colloidal structures, but they work even better. So this is this colloidal crystal, and this is this hype material. So a swing size is now four times larger, and the rate is more than 10 times larger. So this is an example of the applications related to the some advanced materials. And I will probably can skip this bio for tomorrow, and wanted to show you essentially some examples of the materials which are made by atom transfer radical process. So I put this cover from a book which we edited a couple of years ago with Yves Yanou and Ludwig Langler, because it really shows an essence of a macromolecular engineer, which means that first one can design like engineer something, then you have to very precisely make synthetic efforts in order not to use only radical process, can be cationic, can be anionic, coordination, even what Professor Gozawa does, it can be controlled polycondensation-like structures, which will be more chain-bound and step-bound. And then the second volume is on molecular architecture, then on characterization and properties of these materials, and finally by 18 chapters on applications. And this would include some bio, electronic, advanced materials. One of the most nice, in fact, is the first chapter on thermoplastic elastomers. It's the story how Kraton was made in Shell originally. And they wanted to make tires. Eventually, they made shoe soles. And in fact, processing was a key feature for that. It's a Very nice chapter to it, I would strongly recommend. So what we try to do in this micromolecular engineering, in fact, is we really sometimes looking at the properties of the material which we want to have. And then we design the molecular structure, and then prior controlled synthesis and processing, very, very important, hope to get this material. Sometimes not the first time, maybe second cycle will be more successful. So this is a plant which is in Kashima, Japan, and they are making Kaneka polymers by ATRP commercially for probably more than 10 years now. And some applications, especially end functional structures, so they use reactive acrylates. This is an example of a sealants, and they were sealants for artificial marble test. This is a classical silicon sealant, and this is this acrylate ATRP sealant. It really, this is done after 1 month, this is after 4 years. So the reason is that maybe acrylates, they have a more polar structure, they adhere much better to minerals, and also they have a better functionality, and there is no exchange reaction. So silicones, they leach essentially because you have some, maybe some good self-healing properties, but also self-leaching properties, if you wish. So they are making also some sealants for the glass buildings, and they do also something similar for self-cleaning glass. So it's a glass with a very thin layer of a titanium dioxide, and titanium dioxide is a photocatalyst. It destroys any organic impurities, and you have a self-cleaning process. But it cannot do anything with the inorganic components. So if you have a PDMS sealant, then it leaches, and this is a good sealant from that. But also some materials in flat panel displays, and originally people were using a really air gap. Now they have a really filled with a UV resin, but there is a challenge here because you have some parts which can be UV cured, but also you have some shadowed part which cannot be cured. So in order to solve this problem, we are using really two different types of the sealants, those which contain of the cursors, photo curing and also moisture curing systems, and in that case, they cover both of them. This is not my license plate card. This is, I got it from a colleague from Canada, so you could see that in Ontario, they have at least 133 ATRP cars. So I showed that because, in fact, there is some applications, and for years, I think, in Japan, this was from 2008 when they reported that if you use a gasket which is made from not silicone as typically, but it is made from the polyacrylate, then gasoline vapor penetration in this intake manifold is by a factor of 10 less. So it's a good for environment, also for engine performance. And if you look at how they behave, these polymers, this is after 200,000 cycles at higher temperatures. This is practically no damage. This is a silicon material. This is polysulfide, you could see really failure, and this is cyclo-terminated polyethers as well. So this is really performing much better than the others. PPG last year received a prize for the new pigment dispersants, and we are using that for painting airplanes. This is Virgin Atlantic, this is Air Canada. They use also for automotive applications. This is Ford, and I think some other, even Harley Davidson, which surprisingly is red. I was thinking that Harley Davidson is always black. Also interior of cars as well. They use it for smart, also Mini Cooper. Typically red, as you could see here, but in fact, many electronic materials as well, but they can make any tint essentially from that. So it can be used also for powder coatings, these are rims and some utilities appliances as well, and even they use it for art. So it's maybe nicest out of all of them. So I wanted to thank people who work I presented here. So this electrochemistry was done by Sangu and Ming-Jung, most of these nanocarbons, ion catalysts were done by Tanya, molecular brushes by Asha, and bioapplications, which I didn't discuss, in fact, by Sadia and Hong, and the CO2 work was done by Hong Kun and also by Dominic. And I have another picture with a friend of some of yours, so this is Yoshifumi Hamamoto on a roof, maybe before this experiment with photopolymerization was made. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and ask for any questions.